All right, a new series called No Offense. I'm going to start by reading a couple of verses because I'm going to share sort of a lengthy, I'm going to share a story here at the beginning of people. I don't want them to wonder, well, are you going to read some Bible verses just to talk about yourself all morning? So for those folks, I'm going to start with scripture. So Proverbs 19 verse 11 says that a person's wisdom yields patience. It is to one's glory to overlook an offense. I like the way this is translated in the Passion Translation, where it says it this way: an understanding person demonstrates patience, for mercy means holding your tongue when you're insulted. Be quick to forgive and forget, for you are virtuous when you overlook an offense. Over the years, I've worked very hard to be a person who's quick to forgive and overlook an offense. I have a very, if you don't know, I've testified to this a lot of times, I have a very rebellious, very sinful past, and I'm very well aware of my present imperfections. And so I realize how desperate I am in need of God's grace and his mercy on a daily basis. And so I never want to be somebody who's going to withhold God's grace and forgiveness and mercy to those who offend or attack me. And I think, I'm pretty confident that if Charlene or those closest to me were asked, they would testify that I'm not a person who really holds on to a grudge or responds aggressively to an offense. I often, when somebody offends me, will go, okay, what is it about this person that they're saying about me that's actually probably the truth, even if I don't like what they're saying? And of course, I can also, they could testify of moments when I didn't really respond all that well to an offense. In fact, I want to share an example of this with you, something that happened just a couple of weeks ago, maybe 2.5 weeks ago, that confirmed to me that this series of messages is not just for me. I mean, not just for you, it's also for me. So I got to set up the scenario. Okay, so this was just going to take a moment because I need you to understand the context. Otherwise, I don't know, I'll sound worse than it actually is. In fact, Charlene said, baby, are you sure you want to share that? And I'm like, not really, but you want me to front and act like I got it all together. I'm not going to do that. So I'm going to share with you me kind of not probably operating all that Christ-like. Okay, so a few weeks ago, I made an appeal to my online community. For those of you who don't know, I'm a sleight of hand artist, if you want, a magician, if you will, but people get offended by that, and it's just silly tricks. Anyway, I have an online community that I created called the Magicians Forum. Got about 3,000 members, so it's a pretty substantial amount of folks. Anyway, I asked them if they would consider financially supporting the work that I do to provide this resource for them. It cost me money out of pocket, and I just kind of eat that because it's a labor of love. And I said that in exchange, if you give me a small, like, I don't know if it's $1 or $2, whatever it is, I will in return give you this instructional video, two of them, in fact, to teach you how to do some silly tricks. All right, anyway, so that was the deal. And the response was really amazing. Folks were quite generous. I was overwhelmed with messages telling people they wanted to support what I was doing. And every time PayPal sent me a notification saying, you received payment, then I would have to go and look up the email address that was attached to the account and then send them the link. And it was very, very time-consuming. But I really wanted to deliver these videos to them in a timely manner. I wanted to respond quickly and not leave them waiting. Well, a couple of days after I had sent these emails and was sending links out, I got a number of private messages through the forum, not through email, saying, hey, Rude, love you, not mad, but I'm just letting you know I didn't get my links. I'm like, what? I've sent out all the links to anybody who's paid me up to this point. So something was wrong. And so after a little bit of investigation, what I discovered was that there was a lot of people whose PayPal address it's not valid anymore. Some of you might want to check your PayPal account because so my emails were just bouncing or they were going into nowhere. And so what I also discovered was that a lot of these people who came to me through the forum, the reason that they didn't email me, or they did email me, I didn't see it because a lot of the messages ended up in my spam folder. A part of the problem was that I didn't look at my spam folder. I don't really check that often. But the other challenge was that when I finally did go into my spam folder, what I found was just hundreds and hundreds of junk mail that I had to sift through to find these messages and these email addresses. And it's here where my ability to handle offense kind of bubbled up, okay? What I noticed was that hundreds, and I literally mean hundreds of these spam messages that were flooding my inbox were from one person. One person who I know is not really a fan of mine because they have written me letters and told me that. And the subject matter of each, almost every email was about God's judgment and anger and wrath against everybody and their stepmom. Just you get all the things that a lot of what you see, you know, with the signs and God hates this, that, or the other, that list. That's what my inbox looked like. Just a lot of judgment and condemnation and just from one person. And so the good thing I thought was, well, I know this person, so I can kindly ask them, hey, can you just not email me anymore? Take me off whatever list, please. I was really nice, I promise. I snapshotted all these emails so I have proof that I was nice. I tried to be nice. And so I said, can you take me off her list? Well, she responded with nothing. She didn't say, oh, blah, blah, blah. She responded with this verse in the King James, just so you know, just to make sure, you know, sure I understood what time it was. Matthew 10:14. She said, just this verse, whosoever shall not receive you nor hear your words, when you depart out of the house or city, shake the dust off your feet. So she's insinuating, like, I'm dust. Fine, you don't want to hear my words? These, then off with you. I'm like, good. I'm glad to be the dust on your feet. Shake me off, please, in the name of Jesus. And you know what happened? The next day after seeing that, the next day, she doubled down. And there was another 50, maybe 65 messages, same stuff. A fresh batch of 50 emails, all the while, you know, having to sift through them because people are still emailing me. Again, condemnation, God's judgment. And the next day it happened, and the next day. And you probably think, well, Rudy, who cares? It's just spam. We all have spam. No, please. Like, imagine you're expecting some letter in the mail from somebody, something incredibly important that's like, man, time is of the essence, right? Think of it. And then every time you went into your mailbox, it looked like this thing. Can you show them this little? And then you're looking, and then it's just stuffed with junk. You're like, man, I got to sift through all this junk to find this time-sensitive letter. But not just once, every day, because that's what she was trying to do to me. Hey, you understand? Anyway, so I asked her again, and she responded to me, but she didn't address my thing, my concern. It's like she didn't ignore me. I said, can you please stop? She didn't even say that. And she just started saying, hey, when are you going to start really preaching the gospel? When are you going to start preaching the message of repentance and that the end of the world draws nigh and all this stuff? I'm like, that's not the point, girlfriend. That's not the point. Anyway, she wasn't hearing me. I tried blocking her. That didn't work. I don't know why. I even contacted Google to say, I have somebody here who's spamming me. She's abusing your system. Nothing. So I had to resort to extreme measures. I told her, if you don't stop messaging me, I'm going to send you, and I'll show you the video. I'm going to send you this video, and you don't have to play the whole thing, okay, because it's obnoxious. I looked up, what is the most obnoxious song in the world? I said, I will send you this video morning, noon, and night until Jesus comes back or you stop sending me these messages. Here's the video. Roll film. And so I crashed on the top when I'm lying in bed to get it all up, what's in my head. And okay, enough of that, sorry. Okay. And when that didn't work, I found an 80s, a jazzercise video with dudes just, you know, wearing tight stuff. I said, I don't care. And I just kept sending it. Imagine me sitting there I sat there. I must have sent her this video like 150 times. You don't have better things to do, Rudy? No, because she won't stop. Well, it worked. She stops, believe it or not, it actually worked. She sent me a message to me. If you don't stop sending me these things, I'm going to block you. Good, block me. I don't know that I've ever been more thrilled with somebody trying to cancel me. Chihuahua. So, you know, she stopped sending me the messages until, believe it or not, Friday. As I'm writing this message, it starts up again. A fresh batch of Yes, messages. Some left, like, what are you going to do now, Rude? Is you're going to preach to these fine people about how not to be offended. What are we supposed to do when people intentionally or unintentionally offend us? See, the obnoxious thing about this woman's behavior was that, man, even when I tried to be nice and asked her, please stop sending me these emails, she just continued to do it anyway. Just disregarded my messages. I mean, how many of you have someone in your life, kind of like that, who just seems to be out to deliberately try to make your life miserable or difficult? And in ways that are far more offensive and impacting than this, you know, condescending and judgmental, you know, woman with their spam messages. Because you've been offended probably far worse than what I'm just describing right here. I mean, I'm saying it kind of just to be, show you a little bit of my life and how I don't always respond well to an offense. But how does God want you and I to respond to an offense? Over the next several weeks, I want to talk about what the Bible says about how to deal with an offense. And, you know, which you'll be glad to know that there are times, and we see this in the scriptures, when it is appropriate to confront someone when they are in rebellion, when they're sinning against you. And God gives us some very helpful instructions on how we should do that with love and respect. We'll be talking about that in the coming weeks. But for the most part, what we're going to see is that those of us who want to follow Jesus Christ, and I mean really follow him, not just talk about it, but really want to follow Jesus, are called to be unoffendable. There's a book by a gentleman named Brant Hansen, and it's called Unoffendable. I would encourage you to look him up, Brant Hansen, and he has several videos of Bible studies, and it's really, really good stuff if you don't have time to read. Good stuff. But he says this in his book right here. He says, giving up our right to be offended can be one of the most freeing, healthy, simplifying, relaxing, refreshing, stress-relieving, encouraging things we can do. It's a radical, provocative idea. We're not entitled to get offended or stay angry. I know, but she's, like, seriously, hundreds of messages. The idea of our own righteous anger is a myth. It's the number one problem in our society today. Hello, that's really true, this cancel culture that we live in right now. It's the number one problem in our society today, and Christians are just as prone to it. Christians have not been taught out of it. But what if Christians were the most unoffendable people on the planet? Wow, that sounds like a very ambitious goal, maybe an even impossible goal, to be unoffendable. But when you look at the scriptures, as we will, and you look at the life of Jesus and the ways that he responded to things that were really offensive, you'll see that he not only modeled what it is to be unoffendable, he's instructed us to be the same way. You know, sometimes Christians will use the example of Jesus flipping over tables in the temple to justify their righteous anger against things that seem, you know, unjust, sinful. And, you know, here's a meme that communicates this sentiment perfectly. Look, when someone says, what would Jesus do? Remember that flipping over tables and chasing people with the whip is within the realm of possibilities. Wow, really? Or this cute little shirt that you can get from Etsy. This close to flipping tables like Jesus. And she's in the comments, this lady saying, I wore this to church and everybody just loved it. Really? Wow. All right, well, you know, to each their own, I guess. But the presumption here that's being made is that somehow when we're offended, we are entitled to demonstrate our righteous anger in some way, some shape, or form. And again, I'm not saying that there won't be a time when we need to stand up against unrighteousness and injustice and sin, but I think that we have to be very, very careful when we do that. Like King Solomon the Wise, he says this, listen to this proverb. You may believe you're doing right in kind of addressing somebody and their sin or their rebellion or whatever. You may believe you're doing right, but the Lord will judge your reasons. Again, I don't want you to miss it because I think that's really profound. You may believe you're doing right. I know, but you don't know what they did. It is a sin. What they're doing is unrighteous. It's wrong. They've violated my freedoms and imposed themselves upon me in a way that's, whatever the case may be, violated my liberty. You may believe you're doing right in responding to them in some way, teaching them a lesson, but the Lord's going to judge your reasons. He knows the real reason behind why we're acting the way we are. You know, look, again, are there times when we have a justifiable or at least maybe an understandable reason to be angry and offended? Sure, I think, absolutely. But I believe, for the most part, if we're really, 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 truly honest with ourselves and examine our hearts and the reasons why we get so offended and worked up and angry over stuff, most of the time, we'll find that we are, for the most part, just overreacting to some thing that we'd be very wise to overlook. In the moment, this is again from Brandt. In the moment, everyone's anger always seems righteous. Anger's a feeling, after all, and it sweeps over us and tells us we're being denied something that we should have. It provides its own justification, but an emotion is just an emotion. It's not critical thinking. Anger doesn't pause. We have to stop, and we have to question it. We have to question the motives behind why it is that we're responding to an offense the way we do. You know, if anybody ever had a reason to be offended, it was Jesus. I mean, he was opposed and maligned, and he was disrespected and ridiculed, mocked, beaten, spit upon, and of course, ultimately, crucified, even though he'd done no wrong. Says the prophet Isaiah, he was treated harshly, but he endured it humbly. He never said a word, like a lamb to the slaughter. Like a sheep about to be sheared, he never said a word. I want to show you this in the book of Luke. If you have your Bibles, you can turn there. Otherwise, it'll be up here on the screen. But it's Luke chapter 9. And it says this. When the days grew closer for Jesus to be taken up to heaven, he was determined to continue his journey to Jerusalem. And so he sent messengers out ahead of him. And on his way, they went into a Samaritan village to get things ready for him. It's important for us to understand something about Samaria and Samaritans. If you don't know this, there was a very long-standing battle between Jew and Samaritan. Religious and racial differences that were very significant that kept Jews and Samaritans pretty much separated for the most part. Now, at one time, the Jews and Samaritans, they were just one big happy family under King David. Then the Assyrians, they came in and they conquered their country, and their menfolk began, the Jewish ones, hooking it up with Israelite ladies, which resulted in this, I guess you call it like a mixed race of people who were known as Samaritans. And Jews just hated them simply because they were seen as half-breeds. And then add to that they had different ways of worshiping God. They had differences pertaining to where they thought God should be worshipped. They even made their own temple and all this other stuff. So anyway, because of that, the Jews saw the Samaritans as worse than an unbeliever. But what you see in the New Testament is Jesus is always showing love to them. He's always on pursuit of them and makes a deliberate choice to go into Samaria, this place where so many other Jews wouldn't go. But what happens here? Verse 51. But the people would not welcome him. The Samaritans wouldn't welcome Jesus because it was clear that he was on his way to Jerusalem. In other words, because they were in opposition to the beliefs of Jesus and his disciples, they were going to worship a particular way, they deliberately reject him. And they make it difficult for him really to get to Jerusalem. They refuse to care for Jesus and his disciples. And simply because they didn't agree with their religious beliefs. It would almost be the same thing as if you went to a hotel and they turned you away because you were a Christian or because of your skin color or something like that, because of your race. And you can tell that it's very offensive to the disciples by the way that they respond to the situation. Look at this. This is continuing in 54. Okay, well, when the disciples, James and John, who are sometimes referred to as the sons of thunder, says, when the disciples, James and John, realized what was happening, they returned to Jesus and said, and said, well, when the disciples, what the heck, I copied that twice, sorry about that. When the disciples, James and John, saw what was happening, they asked, Lord, do you want us to call down fire from heaven to destroy these chumps? Think about it, these fellows were so offended by the Samaritans' behavior that they wanted literally to kill them. There have been times when I wanted to slap somebody who was coming at me or my family, you know, sideways. But I never wanted to kill anybody. That was one time. But these followers of Jesus, they literally wanted to kill these Samaritans in arguably the most painful way possible. They wanted to call down fire from heaven and roast these people alive. For snubbing them, for disrespecting them. Brutal. But we shouldn't be so quick to judge them, because while we might not want to kill those who offend us, we can respond to an offense in a way that is harmful to ourselves and others. But really, can you think of somebody right now in your life who's offended you, disrespected you, treated you harshly? And I'm not talking about someone who cut you off on the road. A lot of people use that excuse. I mean, that's all right, but no, I'm talking about someone who is intentionally saying or doing things that are making your life incredibly difficult right now. Talking about you behind your back and things of that nature. Blatantly disrespecting you, violating your basic rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And secretly, or maybe not so secretly, you wish that fire would come down from heaven and consume them. Or at least wish that they didn't exist or they would disappear. I think it's important for us to really bring that person to mind. Who is that? I think it's important for us to make this personal. Otherwise, we're going to hear these words and think, oh man, I wish so-and-so was here. No, each of us, I need this message. So bring to mind, who is that person that is driving you nuts right now? They've offended you. Okay. Well, what would Jesus do? Think about how you want to respond and what you want to do versus what Jesus would do. Now, well, here's what happened. So when the disciples and James, James and John saw what was happening, they asked, Lord, do you want us to call down fire from heaven to destroy these people? And Jesus said, yes. How dare they come at you sideways like that? Smoke them. Some people wish Jesus said that. Like, good, see? No, Jesus, he rebuked them. And it says that he rebuked them sharply. This one, hey, guys, hey. Ease up. No, it says he rebuked them sharply. And what did he say? He says, fellas, you don't know what kind of spirit you belong to right now. Because the Son of Man did not come to destroy human lives. He came to save them. And so they went to another village instead. Wow. In those moments when we're offended, and maybe even rightly offended, what would Jesus do? Well, some people looking to justify their anger will turn to the example of Jesus cleansing the temple with the whip. And I'm going to be talking about this more in the coming weeks. For now, I will just remind you, tell you, that Jesus, when he was cleansing the table and flipping tables, cleansing the temple, flipping tables, he wasn't addressing a personal offense. He was angry at injustice. He was frustrated with the religious leaders who were taking advantage of poor people and preventing so-called outsiders, as they viewed them, from coming in to worship God. In other words, his righteous anger was directed at an injustice that was affecting others. See, the actions of Jesus in that moment were truly rooted in a selfless, righteous anger. Man, if you're like me, and most of you are, my anger in those moments when I'm offended, it's me focused. You violated my moral standards and my sense of justice. How dare you? You've trampled on my rights and my freedoms. You sinned against me, so I'm angry. I'm going to let you and everybody on Facebook know. Whatever. Jeez. Some dude, well, anyway, it's not a part of this message. And, well, yeah, it's just, now already forget about it, it's not important. You see it. I sound like Jimmy Stewart. You. Man, this guy put his girlfriend on blast. I think, man, he's offended, and he just blasted her on Facebook for all to see. Lord have mercy, you see that all the time, right? Some of you have done that to other folks. Whether it's because something about the mask thing or the Trump thing or the Biden thing or the Black Lives Matter thing or the whatever thing. And you say, I'm about to flip some tables and start cracking the whip, just like Jesus. Man, is that what Jesus would do? Jesus rebuked them sharply, saying, you don't know what kind of spirit you belong to. The Son of Man did not come to destroy human lives, but to save them. And when we respond to an offense, as I have, you know what, anger or rage, that causes us to want to actually harm those who offend us, Jesus says we're operating from a different spirit than him. See, and what I don't like about me and why this message series is so valuable to me, because that for most of my life, there has been an anger underneath the surface that rises up when I feel that someone's disrespecting me or it threatens my sense of pride. And it's really, really, oh my gosh, got me into some serious trouble over the years. I've been socked in the mouth so many times because I stepped to somebody who I shouldn't have, but they disrespected me, so I got to. That didn't work out a lot for me. Getting socked in the grill is played out, as Rodney Ojukwu said. Anyway, see, and that's the reason it got me into trouble so much is because I was not operating in the spirit of Jesus. I have 1 minute, 39 seconds. In my anger, I was giving the devil a certain degree of control over me, and that's what he does to you too. When we operate in anger, and man, it's not just the world. Christians are so prone to anger. I can't tell you how many people, they don't even come here anymore, or they're mad at me, they've unfriended me, unlike the church, left the church because I didn't do something that they felt I should have been doing, whether it's saying words a certain way or believing things a certain way, or I didn't address a need that I didn't even know they had, and then they're ticked at me. It's like, what do you want me to do? Be a mind reader? I'm a magician. Not a mind reader. It's tricks and stuff, and you want me to read your mind, and now you're mad. Broody, that's a message for another week. Okay. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26, verse 27. I'm telling you, when we respond like that, we are giving the devil a foothold. He's bringing division. He creates all sorts of havoc in our lives. If you become angry, which is, it happens. If you become angry, it's not saying don't become angry. The assumption is you are. If you become angry, don't let your anger lead you to do dumb stuff, sinful things. And don't stay angry all day or all week or all month or for years, which is even worse. If you become angry, I'm going to read it again. If you become angry, do not let your anger lead you into sin, Rudy. And don't stay angry all day. Do not give the devil an opportunity to defeat you, which he will if we continue to operate in anger and always being all easily offended because of all the various ways and reasons why we get offended. Now, thank God, by the power of his Holy Spirit, I have gotten so much better. I've been able to restrain that anger, and God has awakened me to the source of it, which is really important. Now, I understand why I get angry. Stuff that happened when I was a little kid. That I said, I'm not going to let, no one's going to push me around. No one's going to tell me this, that, or the other. It has not worked out well for me. But I've gotten better. But I still have work to do. How about you? It's a more important question. Would those who know you best, really think about this, because a lot of people think, oh, no, I don't get offended easily. Yeah, you do, bro. Yes, you do, sister. Ask those closest to you. Would those who know you best say that you're easily offended and quick to be angry and hold a grudge? These little men, they're always angry. You don't want to cross them sideways. They will cut you. And then you take pride in that. Yeah, you're right. Yes, you are right. I will cut you You know, and people take pride in that. Like, yep, you don't want to mess with me. This week, and I'm closing with this. Here's my challenge to you and to me. This week, take note of how many times you get offended from one day to the next. Make even tally it, going, one, right on your hand. Once, twice, three times. Somebody flip you off on the road, whatever. From the littlest thing to those things that are significantly hurtful and painful, to those times when somebody violates your moral standards, or those people who intentionally seek to hurt you, or be mindful of your attitude. Take note of your words and the tone of your words and the actions that you take in response to those offenses. Take note of those. Bring a mindfulness to your behavior with regard to how you respond to an offense. I'm going to do that as well. And in the coming weeks, I'm going to challenge all of us to examine how we respond to an offense and compare it to how Jesus humbly responded to those who offended him. And my hope and my prayer for myself and all of you here and those watching is that we will become more like Jesus and less like the world. And that's all I'm going to say about that. I'm going to invite the worship team to come on up. Well, thank you. Oh, my goodness.